And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing. And now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way. Yes, it was my way.
You like how on that video, when it says regrets, I have a few, my photo comes up? I mean, Why does that happen? I can confidently say that John O. Would want you all to know, seeing you all here and in your faces, that he would want you all to know that all of his art is for sale. There are people with credit card machines. And that all of the sticker price that's on there is incorrect, but now it's doubled posthumously. So if there's a sticker price on a piece of art of his that you like, I would take advantage of it and get it now, because likely the ghost of John will wake me up somehow with a cardinal pecking on my door saying, double it immediately. But seriously, welcome everyone to the celebration of life for Cano Ozgener. He wanted to have a celebration of life. He didn't want it to be a an occasion that was too sad. He wanted it to be more of a celebratory event. My father's story is one about how the desire to make oneself and everything around you better through education, hard work, honesty, positive morals and ethics, reputation, perseverance, focus, and being opportunistic led to the achievement of the American dream. Now, it's been really overwhelming and heartwarming to my family to see you all here today. Thank you very much for taking time on a Sunday to come out here and join us to celebrate his memory, as well as to all of the wonderful outpouring of sentimental messages of love, respect, and great stories of my father. Thank you all for these wonderful gifts. Cano's obit page on ozartsnashville.org received more than 2,500 page views from people over 40 different states and 31 different countries, which is a great reminder to us that Cano touched a broad reach of people of all backgrounds, nationalities, ethnicities, and ages. And I've been really moved by the impact that he's had on his grandchildren. And so at this moment, I would actually like to invite them to come on stage so that I can interview them briefly. So I would like to invite Allo Frank, who is my niece. Come on up, Allo. And Evan Ozgener, my son, and Sean Frank, my nephew, and Aiden Ozgener, my youngest son, to come on stage so that we can learn about, like, what did they learn? What are some life lessons you might have learned from their granddad? So, you all are here. Allo, stand over there. There you go. Now, I'm going to ask you all, like, they called their granddad their day-day. So, Allo, like, what do you, will you remember, or what did you learn from your granddad?
Whenever I liked to paint with him, he would always be there when I learned how to paint. And he showed me, like, the flowers on some of the paintings, how to do and use the technique, how to put it on.
That's great. Do you still use that technique?
I tried to, and I showed my art teacher it, and she was amazed.
That's awesome. Thank you very much. Allo. All right, Evan, what did you learn from your granddad, or what will you remember him by?
I learned that how art can help you heal, help you feel different emotions, depending on the colors, the shapes in art, and how if you're feeling different emotions while you're painting it, it will look different ways.
That's great. Does this help you when you're playing Fortnite?
It actually does.
My wife and I don't believe you. Okay. Sean, How did your granddad, your day-day, impact you?
Well, I remembered him by, he went to my school events even though that he was sick with cancer.
Oh, that's nice. So that was a really kind of a brave testament for him to show up at your school and sit there with you. Was it there for was it a granddad's day?
Yes.
Okay, great. Is there anything else, any other memories that you might have from him?
Actually, I do. Back in the good old days, we made fun of a phrase, coach.
Coach, but it's not coach like a football coach, right? It's a different, there's a Turkish saying, for those of you that are not Turkish, which I'm confident is like 98% of the room. Coach means like, it's like a ram. So it's like, it's sort of a term of endearment, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
There you go. Thank you, Sean. All right, Aiden, what are you going to remember him by?
Every time, he told me not to listen to anybody else's advice, but listen to your own advice.
That excludes your father and mother, right?
Maybe.
Houston, we have a problem. All right, well, thank you all very much. You guys are wonderful grandkids. He loved you very much. So, my father was a tough man. I mean, not like mean, but you know, he was a resilient person. He may have been short in his size. I'm short too, so what are you gonna do? But he was strong-minded, determined, detail-driven, and had a zest for life. So, when it came to visiting doctors to talk about battling cancer, or any other health issue, he was predictably meticulous. He overcame lymphoma with an arduous stem cell procedure in 2002, open heart surgery with an aortic valve replacement, and prostate cancer. And he survived all of these with a positive outlook and with a purposeful balance of Western medicine and Eastern practice, such as acupuncture, yoga, meditation. He was diagnosed with an advanced pancreatic cancer on March of 2017, and he lived an additional 15 months after surviving 18 chemotherapies and 10 radiation therapy treatments, which, as you can imagine, quite difficult. He and my mother would both come prepared to their meetings with their doctors, doing research, asking the right questions, and taking arduous notes, and consulting the right people before and after visits. They sought counsel with people who were qualified, experienced, detail-driven like themselves, accomplished, thorough, realistic but encouraging, and with a keen intellect. And one of these individuals, in fact, their go-to guy, who epitomized all these qualities, is Dr. Alp Ikizler. Dr. Alp Ikizler is the Catherine McLaughlin Hakim Associate Professor of Medicine at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. He's Director of Clinical Research in Nephrology and also Medical Director and CEO at the Vanderbilt University Outpatient Dialysis Unit. He's been an invited lecturer both nationally and internationally at meetings and has over 100 publications and books and scientific journals to his name. But most importantly, he and his wife, Minnie, are what I would call the closest of friends and even part of our family. So it's my great pleasure to introduce, to say a few words about Jono, Dr. Alp Ikizler.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Tim, thank you very much, and it's really a big honor and privilege to be here. So first of all, I would like to thank the Ozgener family for giving me the opportunity to be here and speak about Jono, which I don't think that any word is going to do justice for him, for what he has accomplished. But also, knowing who he is, what he has capable of, and what he has accomplished over the years, I think it's a very humbling and a very stressful process for me. Tim is right, I have given a lot of talks, but I've never given a talk like this, which has so much personal touch to it. But I thought, well, if the kids can do it, I can do it. So anyway, before I go ahead and talk about this short period of time about Cano, I'd like to recognize a couple of people. All of you here are actually great friends of Cano, as I will allude in a couple of minutes. And I think all of you had special place in his heart and his life for various reasons. But I'd like to acknowledge a couple of individuals who have been very close to him over the last couple of years to fulfill his dream of Oz Arts. And that is the members of the Board of Trust for Oz Arts. These individuals, most of them, I think all of them are here. And I will read their names. I think they all deserve to be here and do the same speech as I am giving. And they're probably going to do much better than I can. But I think it'll be nice to at least recognize them for being with him and really fulfilling his dream that's going to come through in a very strong way. So I will read their names one by one, and I would like you to hold your applause until the very end. And at the end, I would like those individuals to stand up so we can really recognize them. Max Goldberg, Mike Hodges, Jerry Jones, James Kelly, Janet Miller, Sherry Neal, Arnita Ozgener, Eileen Ozgener, Mark Rowan, Lori Seabury, Hope Stringer, and Jimmy Wilson. And I'm proud to say I'm also a board member. Would you please rise if you're here? So, Cano was a perfectionist. So this talk cannot be too long, cannot be too short. It has to be perfect. Okay, all of you in this audience know Cano for one reason or another, so I'm not going to go over his life or his unique accomplishments. We'll be here for the next week. So we'll just talk about what Cano meant to our family, actually to my wife and I, and our children, who are not, unfortunately cannot be here for various reasons. While these two or three specific personal and unique anecdotes are and thoughts are apparently unique to me and the way I appreciate it and my wife, which I talked to her and got some advice of what to say here, I think you will also recognize and appreciate the fact that they can also relate to you as well. And you can really get something out of it as your experience with Cano over the decades that you've known him. So I would like to say that he knew everyone very well, as I will say in a couple of minutes, and he really appreciated everyone's presence around him, and he loved to see an audience like this. So thanks for being here. So let's start for the audience and the individuals who want to be here, who really would desire to be here, but just cannot be here for one reason or another. And you may, again, you know, you may actually wonder, why am I here? Some of you may not even know me, probably, never heard of my name. And as I will, again, allude to, I don't even think that I'm the longest friend for Cano Ozgener family, but I'm here. But I think I've established, I personally and my wife as well, with the family and Cano specifically, and SN and SNTZ as we call her, a specific bond over the last several years. I cannot remember how long. But during his illness, I was his go-to guy in terms of asking questions, getting information. And he and I had a lot of conversations, very personal at times. Patient-physician related conversations, giving advice for his medical care and giving advice for other things and listening to him to talk about things. And I would say for this audience, I want you to remember when you leave this place, as I talked to him many times, our conversations always circle about around one thing, and that was very special. He always talked about something or someone that did something very well, and how much he appreciated that thing, and how much he wanted to do it as well, and how much he wanted to do even better. So I think he recognized and knew each one, every one of you here in this audience very well, more than you think. And he appreciated the big good things about you, the things that are special about you. And he communicated that, those to me as things that he would like to do in the future. So as we talked about different things, and as I look at this audience, this is an overwhelmingly accomplished audience, unique individuals. We also talked about a lot of different things. We talked about medicine, how medicine should be, how the way we practice as well as holistic medicine should be. We talked about business. He gave me a lot of business advice, which unfortunately I didn't follow. We talked about art, I mean, he was just phenomenal to give us so much advice, taught us about art. And we talked about science and different things. He was an engineer. So as I was thinking about this and trying to reflect into my talk, he was a man of broad range of intellectual capability. So when Tim asked me how to title the talk, I quickly came up with this title of Renaissance Man, the modern Renaissance Man. It was so easy. He really reflected this unique individual that can do many, many things and absorb everything that he can, wanted to learn and teach people. So as with any Renaissance Man that you would think of in your lives, he was an extraordinary individual. He achieved everything that he can to the maximum potential, and he embraced any possible opportunity that was in front of him, as much as selling his art for twice as the money, which is true. He was an engineer by training, but he was also self-made, a very successful businessman, and an individual who was reborn as an artist, who was actually very talented. I am proud to say that I have several of his paintings in my house that we put it at the best place we can, and we look at him every day. My wife and I really look at him every day as much as we can. Again, as any unique individual in his place, what he has accomplished, he was very curious. He was willing to learn from anyone. That's why he knew each and every one of you more than you thought you would. He knew everything about you. He knew the good things about you, and he wanted to do the same good things for himself and people around him. So he loved people. He loved travel. He loved to learn what people's backgrounds and experiences are. So as we came here to celebrate his life, I also would like to say that please do know that he appreciated and loved each and every one of you. In terms of us, as I was thinking about what to say today, there are so many things to say. I tried to remember the first interaction that I had with him, and believe it or not, I just couldn't. I just couldn't remember when it was. It was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And I was going through things. It just sort of dawned on me that I felt like I knew Cano all my life. And it may sound as cliche to you, but that really reflected what Ozgener family meant to us. Just to give you a couple of examples. Cano is from Turkey, as I am. And he's from an Armenian descent, which he was proud of. And thanks to 23andMe, I have 5% of that too. His house, where he lived, born, raised, is actually in an area of Istanbul called Moda, on the European side. And I would suggest you go visit that place. It is only 5 minutes to my house. It is the same area that my wife spent all her childhood going to the beaches. He, Esenteyze, I, and my wife, Mine, went to the same school. We went to high school for Robert College, the first prominent educational establishment that was American outside of the United States, established and founded in 1863. He was proud of it, and I was proud of it. He also wrote for the same soccer team. He had a love for soccer. He said he was a Fenerbahce fan, but I always had my doubts because I think he watched me watching a game, and he said he'd better be a Fenerbahce fan after seeing me. But most importantly, what really made the difference was that we were both immigrants. My father was an immigrant too, so we had a lot of discussion around that theme with him in different many ways about being an immigrant and how important, how difficult it was. As any one of us who's been through that, he was a very courageous man, as was Esenteyze. Their marriage is a story of its own, but please do consider that these individuals are getting married in early 1960s, coming from a different religious, ethnic, and cultural background. They have gone through a lot of boundaries and they made it the best way possible. This also speaks to their perseverance and determination. Not only they got married, but they also established a new life in a country across the ocean in the 1960s. You know all about his business endeavors and his successes and how they settled in Nashville, and you know all about him. And I think he's become more Nashvillian than anyone that has been in this place for decades and generations and has given more to Nashville than any Nashvillian can. Now, despite that being Nashvillian to the core and to the heart, what really made Cano different was that this subtle but very strong tie to his background and the way he acted and he lived. And it's a very hard thing to explain what that background is. So when I looked at him and my wife looked at him all the time, he was a real gentleman. He was always polite. He was very elegant. He was very stylish but also classical at the same time. He was thoughtful but critical at the same time, but never in a damaging or intimidating way. So these attributes went on and on and on. And then I really recognized, and I talked to this to my wife as well, he was like our father, my uncle, my teacher back in Turkey, or our neighbors, or a combination thereof, the better of all of them. So for the 2% of Turkish people here, I'm going to use the term, he was a Istanbul beyefendisi, the gentleman from Istanbul. This is a classy genre of individuals who are so hard to find now and then. I will finish my talk, my speech, with a short anecdote about him, which I think sort of summarizes what I feel and how I really appreciate his life. About a year ago, my wife and I celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary, so we invited Cano and Esen to our dinner. Not unexpectedly, Cano showed up with a bottle of wine, and I looked at the bottle, and excuse my French, it's Chateau Mouton Rothschild. It was dated 1987, 30 years old, the year that my wife and I got married. So I was not good, and my wife is not either, so we didn't know what kind of a wine it was, but it really looked good. So we opened, I tasted it, it was okay. But I asked him, I said, Cano, what do you think? Is the wine good? Is it good enough for your taste? He said, you know what, it really didn't matter how the wine tasted for him as long as it was not vinegar. It was the real value of the wine and the taste that he got out of it was that he was able to have it, bring it to a special occasion and share it with us. So as I reflect back to that date, it's sort of like a picture that Cano thought about 30 years ago that he would paint, a masterpiece in his mind, that he initially started and put many, many strokes to that painting until the very last stroke that night that made a masterpiece for us, masterpiece for me and my wife. Thank you very much.
They had a cigar from Nicaragua, which was the best-selling cigar. Therefore, I knew that Nicaragua and Honduras had beautiful land, beautiful climatic conditions, and with the proper seed, the Cuban seeds, you can have a very good harvest over there. It's a country like Cuba also from where you can get from one region versus the other very different kind of soils, therefore tobacco, and different altitudes, again, which affects the tobacco, and thus different aromas, different flavors. When you mix these, really you can come up with beautiful cigars. Since all this is a very involved process, making the cigars, you know, the cultivation of the cigars, we want to make sure that our customers understand that we are picky for every detail. And the bands have to be made in the best place in the world, and they have to be perfect. The boxes have to be perfect, so that we tell you we have not neglected any detail during this whole process, and we don't. We were all born and we will all die. How you live life is very important, so that everybody who is involved in this chain of making the cigar is committed to make the best and try to achieve the best is the bottom line, I think.
So, such a wonderful man, such a great father, friend, mentor, rich in life experiences and achievements. And the beauty is that he took us on this ride with him, which has enriched our lives with so many life lessons and stories. In fact, so many stories that when I looked at them all after I wrote them down on paper, I asked myself, I mean, how in God's name am I ever going to categorize these? And I had no idea. So, you know, I flipped through his books, which he has as parting gifts for you, by the way, which he would say, well, if you already have a book, get another one and give it to a friend. So have them. And in his second book, I found a passage that somehow clicked with me, and it says, I have been an engineer, a businessman, a philanthropist, an innovator, and an artist all my life. I have integrated these throughout my life, from the food I ate, to the pipe and cigar I smoked, to the art I made. An engineer is an innovator, and so is an artist. I was born to Armenian parents in Istanbul, Turkey, a city bridging east and west. One side of the Bosphorus is Asia, and the other is Europe. I traveled this divide almost 300 days a year for many years, and it was this background that made me multicultural and cosmopolitan. Raised as a Christian, exposed to Islam and Judaism, I was an altar boy in a French Catholic church doing Latin Mass one day, and the next day, an altar boy in the Armenian Orthodox Church. All of these experiences with the constant, five times a day, sound of the Muslim call of ezan or prayer have molded my religious tolerance, colored my art palette, and still continually influence me. And my art, the rainbow, I have found with fascination, is a universal constant. It's the same in Nashville, New York, Istanbul, and even Kuala Lumpur. It has the same shape, an arc, which is a geometric shape, and it has the same colors and order, color spectrum. It comes only at a moment when nature is at peace, after thunders, rains, and tempests. It suggests serenity, calm, peace. It can help you relax, appease, embrace, and enjoy your true self. I have adopted the rainbow as my guide in my paintings, and they purposefully assigned numbers to the colors in the order that they appear in the sky. Red is 1, orange 2, yellow 3, green 4, light blue 5, dark blue 6, violet 7, purple 8. And one can see the relevance of these colors in the chakras of our bodies. I add colors for the number 9, an earthy brown. After reading this passage, it became clear to me, of course, I can organize these lessons and stories in the colors of the rainbow, or how my father assigned colors with these numbers for his paintings, and especially his pie paintings. So, I mean, actually, I've sort of organized these by, like, lessons that I've learned from my father that I wanted to share with you. So I'm going to start with lesson one. Lesson one is the color red. Be positive. So in the 90s, I was living in Los Angeles. I went to college there. And my father influenced me to get into yoga, which I did and I loved. And one of our favorite teachers was a woman named Shiva Ray. And she was doing a yoga retreat in Utah along the Green River. So I signed up, Jono and I, 6 months in advance. And when the time came to go, I called my dad and I said, look, the retreat is next week. Are you ready? And Jono was like, well, I have my plane ticket and the yoga mat. And yes, where are we staying? I'm like, Dad, in a tent, Dad. We are paddling down a river in Utah, doing yoga on stops, and spending the night in sleeping bags in a tent. And there's a pause on the line. And my dad's like, what are you talking about? I thought we were going to be at the Ritz. I'm like, Utah has a Ritz, no? I'm like, where are we going to the bathroom? I'm like, I don't know, in nature, I guess. And there was a slight pause, and then he was like, I am not going. he ended up recognizing that it would be a great kind of father-son experience and bonding opportunity, and he went, and he had a solid and sunny, positive outlook on the trip, and you know, people gravitated to him, and he ended up being like kind of everybody's dad on the trip. So, you know, he made the most out of a situation that he thought would be bad. So that was my lesson one. Lesson two, orange, do your best. So my beautiful wife Arnita and I were getting ready for our nuptials in Northern California, and I had my groomsmen all lined up to have vanilla-colored tux jackets and black pants. And the wedding was a few days away when I received a call from the rental shop in Santa Rosa, California, telling me they were good with all of the other groomsmen but one, named K. Cano Ozgener. So I asked my dad, I said, Dad, you know what gives? Put into order for the tux already. I mean, everybody else has given their measurements. And my dad's like, son, listen, okay. You have deemed me the best man, no? And I'm like, yeah. This means, by definition, that I must look the best, no? I'm like, if you take it that literally, okay, but you know, so if I rent from the tuxedo shop, who cannot make me look the best? Because, first of all, they will not have a jacket that will be complimentary of my height. Then I will find a better solution. And what's that? My Armenian friend, a tailor in New York, Ned Sororian, do you know him? He has a store, Mr. Ned's. I'm like, what? Of course, an Armenian man's store will be called Mr. Ned's after his first name. He will make a jacket for me of the exact color, beautifully. Long story short, the jacket got made barely in the nick of time. He left it on a plane. He had to take it on a plane with him. He forgot it in the overhead bin. We had to rush it to get it to the wedding in time. But he got there, and admittedly, he looked great, don't you think? Lesson 3, yellow, follow your karma. So, some of our favorite times as a family occurred on some epic road trips we'd taken together on summer vacations. Some great, some seemingly start off great, and end up being disasters like this canoe trip where my mom and sister bailed on us and my dad and I had to paddle down the river. But they were always memorable. So we had one that we were going to Rome, Italy. And so we had to rent a car. I was the designated driver. And we found out right before we leave, a week before we're supposed to leave, that every car in Italy is a stick shift, is a manual. And no one in our family ever has driven stick. So we're like, what are we going to do? My sister has a friend at Hillsborough High School who teaches me how to drive stick in the parking lot of Hillsborough High School the Sunday before we leave. Really bad idea. So we get over there, we get in the car, like some guy has delivered to us in like black suits, like near the Colosseum, and we get in there and it's like herky jerk to say the least, which of course Jono is like, this is absolutely the worst idea ever. How stupid am I to go on this trip? And everybody's trying to be positive. My dad's like, my God, what a disaster. I'm like, Dad, would you just be quiet? So we're driving all around. I figure it out eventually, the gear shifts and stuff like this. And then we go to this town near Portofino called Camoli, which is famous for its pesto. And we go to this like kind of pension hotel, and I had this water in between my legs, and I spilled the water on my pants. So we go to check into the hotel. Now at these hotels, we would always get separate rooms. It would be like two rooms, one room for me and my mom and my sister, and the other one for Jono, because he snored so bad. So of course, whenever we would go to check in, he would be checking in. He'd be like, why you want two rooms? He'd go, you know, I am really an abused husband. Do you know it? Have you seen me before? They abuse me. I do not want to stay with them. They smell really bad. You know, so I was like, so we go to our room, I take off my pants and I put them over the windowsill, and then like my wallet is in there and it spills all over this balcony below. I'm like, oh my God, it's a disaster. I got everything at my driver's license, how many, it's a massive balcony. And I realized that my dad had a room adjacent to us that kind of over, was a little bit lower hanging. You know, these Italian hotels are a bit weird. So it was a little lower, and I went to my dad's room and I figured I could probably jump from his balcony on this massive balcony below and get all my driver's license and like one card and some cash. And so I walked into this room, my dad's like laying down, he was taking a nap, and my dad liked to kind of like have his shirt off, and he was laying there, and he's like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I dropped my wallet, and I gotta get it, so I'm gonna climb off the balcony and jump down to get it. What the hell are you, Superman or something? I mean, what a complete moron. Wake me up before you go-go. Anyway, do it. So I jump down and I land on my heel and I feel like I've broken my heel. So I was like not in good shape and I'm limping, and then my mom's like, oh my God, he broke his foot.
What are we to do, Jano? I told that idiot not to jump from the balcony. Listen, Essen, this town is famous for its pesto, and damn it, I will have it. I am not dealing with this character and his shenanigans, or what do you call, anyway. So I'm limping, and finally they take me to the hospital. We go there in Camoli, and there's a guy, he looks like he could be a doctor or a barber. I mean, it's like the same outfit, right? And so he's like, does this hurt? No. Does this hurt? I'm like, yeah, it hurts. You're punching my foot. So anyway, my father the whole time was ridiculing me. What a stupid thing to do. And you know, in Turkey, you have this saying that if you make fun of somebody too much, it's going to come back and bite you. That's why they have all those like evil eye looking things in Turkey. So, you know, we go to Istanbul to visit the relatives. We're staying in my mom's, my grandmother's, on my mother's side's cottage. And there's this big hubbub one morning. I'm like, what is going on? They're like, you know, oh, I forgot to give a preface. Very important, this story. We stopped at Arezzo the day before we left to go back to Turkey. And again, we're staying in separate rooms. Our room was like on the hallway, like down on one end, and my father's was on the other. He woke up early. And he was like, well, I will go in this beautiful town, medieval town, Arezzo, and I will do a run and a walk, and I will buy my family, you know, bread and jam and cheese and wake them up, and we will have a continental breakfast. So he goes and does that. He goes back to his hotel room. He's taking a shower. In the shower, there's no separation between, like, the toilet, the bidet, and the shower, and he steps on the shower mat, and there's soap underneath the shower mat, unbeknownst to him, and he slips up, and he hits the side of his ribs on the bidet, and he's in such excruciating pain. He doesn't know what to do, but the first thing that comes to his mind is to open the door and crawl down the hall naked and dripping and knock on our door. And Essen's like, oh my God, it's too early. Who could this be? And she opens the door, oh my God, Jano, you are naked. And my dad's like, on all fours, dripping. I am really in pain here, you know, woman, do something. So then when we're in Turkey, there's all this commotion. I'm like, what happened? He's like, your dad, I think, broke his ribs. And I'm like, really? And I walk into the bedroom because it would just had been a fracture. And I said, and here he is. He's like laying like this, and he's completely naked with like a sheet between his, like, and he's like, looks like Emperor Nero. And I'm like, Dad, what the hell? And he's like, do not make me laugh. Do not make me breathe. Do not make me move. Get me a jar. I have to pee. This is a picture from that trip in Istanbul. So that, but you know, that's karma, right? So he taught me about karma. That's my lesson there. Lesson four, green, which is a sense of humor. Of course, you all know he had a natural sense of humor and was always affable and could laugh at himself. I'll never forget his go-to jokes, which is, I am from Nashville, Tennessee. Can't you tell from my accent? Well, you know, today is Thanksgiving, and we are about to carve a turkey. And, you know, Essen and I are from Turkey. And by the way, you know what language we speak there? I'm like, Dad, please don't tell this joke. Gabel, gabel, gabel. It's a good one, no? Gabel, gabel. You get it? Anyway, next. And there was even one road trip we went on that he thought it was hilarious. And he's like, look at all of these camels. I will pause and tell my friends that I have switched vocations. I am a used camel salesman. My fifth lesson that I learned from him is light blue color. The details are important. Improve on whatever it is that you're in. And so our good friend David Savona from Cigar Aficionado magazine actually captured it brilliantly here.
Jano, can you just tell us a little bit about how you founded CAO, how you took this idea to make something better and turned it into what it is today?
I'm a research engineer by profession. I used to do research for DuPont, and I thought that I can improve on the meerschaum pipes to start with, and therefore I made slight modifications, no brain surgery, and which was well received by the American pipe smokers. And I'm proud to say that we had one of the best meerschaum pipes in the industry. And after that, when the cigar boom happened, I saw the same opportunity in a larger scale in the cigar industry.
Now, when you started this company, it wasn't like a big warehouse, a big office. It was in your home, wasn't it?
On the basement of my home, like all American dreams.
And who were your first employees? Was it your family?
My son and my daughter.
So you go from a company in your basement, and then all of a sudden, you transform it into a much larger company.
From the Meerschaum pipes, which is a small niche business, we went into humidors, actually.
And where were these humidors made?
They were made in Nashville, Tennessee, and Kentucky. Mm-hmm.
Now, what's a cigar company doing in Nashville, Tennessee?
You can blame my wife for that. When I came to this country, I wanted to be in New York City. And then I followed this young lady, and she changed my life. Instead of New York City, it became Nashville, Tennessee. You all come back over there, you hear?
Now tell me about going from making pipes and then humidors into making cigars.
When you make pipes or when you make humidors, they don't burn. It's a finite sale that you have. When you make cigars, you have to burn it when you smoke it, and therefore you have to buy another one. It took me 30 years to learn that.
It seems like a better business model.
You have to think big. Whatever I do, I would like to think that we can be the best cigar, we can make cigars that the people will like. That was our goal, and I never think small. To me, there is no part-time job. We had a good, solid foundation, and setting up the foundation is very important in any business, and also commitment. The secret of this is having a good tobacco. You start from there.
Coming from your engineering background, you used engineering to change the way a pipe works. Is there a way to make that work in the cigar business?
The way that you look to every business, you look at it, how can I improve this process? How can I make it better? And you should not be satisfied with the status quo. You should always look forward of what else.
A lot of people say that the cigar business is really art, but there's also some science involved.
I love that combination. My father was a jeweler, and I'm a semi-art collector, but also I'm a scientist. However, if I'm going to take one of them, I take the artist rather than the scientist.
Oh, the artist wins over the scientist.
Well, I think so.
Jano, it's always a pleasure to smoke a cigar with you. Thank you very much for being here today.
Okay, thank you.
So this switch was always on for him. I mean, you know, he always had to be focused on that detail. I remember, like, he came to watch me. I did some stand-up comedy in L.A., and my mom and him went to see me, and it was like 20 comedians or something like this, and I went last, and there was somebody in between, and then afterwards, Jono came to talk with me. He's like, "Son, you were very good job, but let me tell you something. The comedian, I think she was number 13 or something. She was talking about her jokes were about her breasts. Why?" I'm like, "Well, Dad, I mean, I don't know. I mean, that was her shtick. I have a different shtick. But why should she be joking about her breasts? I mean, have you seen her breasts?" I'm like, "Dad, I admittedly have not been looking at her breasts. They are beautiful." I'm like, "Okay." I'm like, I will tell her, "Dad, it's probably not a good idea. We're in California." I'm like, "Excuse me, young lady. Well, your name again? Jessica, let me tell you something. Do not joke about those breasts. I mean, they are beautiful." So anyway, like, you know, then the next day she went to the airport to leave to go back, and my parents went, "There we go." So then, like, she was at the airport, my parents were at the airport, and she sees my father across security. She's like, Mr. Ozgener. My dad was like, "Yes, I told you so. Don't criticize them." There's a true story. Lesson 6, dark blue, determination, competitive spirit. So, you know, my father was international ping pong champion of Istanbul. And later, he became a great tennis player. And And you know, he also developed a great friendship with the maestro Kenneth Skirmerhorn. So he and my father would get together and play tennis, and then he would always come to me. I'd be like, "Dad, how did it go? I know that Mr. Skirmerhorn's a pretty good tennis player." He goes, "Yes, Kenneth, you know, he has a lot of energy. He is tall, much taller than me, obviously, and he can run like a little rabbit around the court." I'm like, "So what do you do against him?" He goes, "Well, you know, I make him go forehand, backhand. I run him around, up and back to the net again, and I get him tired, and then I suck it to him." There was another time that, like, my sister and I, we had an Atari. Who had an Atari growing up? Y'all have an Atari? Anyway, so we had Miss Pac-Man, and my sister and I were playing Miss Pac-Man, and Jono tried it, and he was terrible. We're like, "Dad, you should just give this up." And so we went to bed, and he was on the sofa by the TV. We came back the next morning. We're getting ready to go to school. We come out there, and he's playing Miss Pac-Man again. We're like, "Jono, have you been playing Miss Pac-Man all..." "Shh, I have turned the board over 2 times. So he would figure it out. All right, number 7, light purple. Quality appreciation for the finer things. You know, he loved fine wines. He loved cheeses and bread. He loved coffee. In fact, Ted and Debbie Clark, you guys are here. You know, can you just wave your hands here? So when Ted and Debbie Clark, dear old friends of ours who had a tobacconist in Evansville, Indiana, would come out, he would roast coffee for you all. And he bought these green coffee beans that he had in the freezer, and he would put them in a pan. And when they roasted, it emitted so much smoke that we thought the whole house was burning down. In fact, I remember in the morning going in like, "Mom, what's happening?" And she's like, "Your father is roasting coffee." And I like go in the kitchen, I could see these slippers and nothing else, all the smoke. I'm like, "Dad, are you out of your mind? You do not understand quality in coffee, do you?" "Don't talk to me about these things, please." In fact, then I took him to a crawfish boil, and you know, he could eat a lobster like nobody's business. So at the crawfish boil, he's like, "What are all these people doing?" I'm like, "They're eating the tails and discarding the heads." "Why are they discarding the heads?" "They don't eat the heads, Dad." "What? They are missing the best part." So my dad went over there and started sucking the heads, and everybody at the party is like, "What's he doing?" He's like, "Just give him the heads." You know, so like... All right, so lesson 8, dark purple, the value of hard work. He definitely taught us the value of hard work and that nothing in life comes easy. And this is my sister and I at child labor. It's probably why I lost all my hair. You have to be focused, passionate, have 100% commitment, and work hard. So I'll never forget one time when we had our cigar business, we were interviewing a salesman who was a pretty good salesman we heard from Rhode Island. He was a little too cocky, to be honest with you. And, you know, we just asked him the standard question, what do you do for hobbies? And he's like, "Well, you know, I'm like a really good golfer. I'm like a 6 handicap, you know? I mean, I've been working pretty hard on my golf game, and yeah, I'm pretty good." And so we interviewed him, the guy leaves, and my dad looks at me right after. He's like, "Let this be a lesson to you, son. If a man is bragging about how low their handicap is at golf, he is not working." Actually, I like golf, and there's some good golfing buddies here, so. All right, so last one, lesson 9, brown, think big. Vision is very important. You know, after we sold our cigar business and, you know, he came to want to start Oz Arts because of a health kind of scare that he had, and that art kind of gave him the inspiration to want to live the beauty of, like, people singing lullabies to him or the colors of nature around him. And we were inspired by other cities and what we saw happening in, like, you know, Brooklyn or Miami or Portland or even other places in Europe. And art, he claimed, kind of saved his life, you know. And we would always talk about how it provides inspiration, motivation, and hope. He would always say, "When things are dark and seem hopeless, you will find a light there, and it will be art." So, obviously, we always had fun with it. And, you know, art can be a great conduit to open our hearts and minds and to make us more aware of problems and issues around these problems. But it also makes you see and appreciate the beautiful things in life. It makes us better humans, makes us more compassionate and empathetic. So what a great visionary he was then, to foresee that now, more than ever, we need these things. Now more than ever, we need that bridge. And now more than ever, we need art in all of its forms. And it's happening here in this room. And it happens here. And for those of you that have never been here to see a performance, I encourage you to come see something here and absorb it. Finally, he had been talking for years since he had first met Renee Fleming at the Nashville Symphony. And he was really moved by her performance. He became almost, you know, really kind of enamored with her and her grace and elegance and how she presented herself as a performer. And so he wanted us to bring Renee Fleming over here, which our artistic director was like, well, it's not necessarily, she's not necessarily contemporary art. I mean, she's singing songs from the old masters. And my father was always like, no, she is doing more contemporary things now. You see, I will show you. She is doing some rock stuff too, you know, so it was a continual conversation. But at the end of the day, and it was a jostling back and forth through a lot of channels to get her here, but at the end, she came here. And she performed here in December of 2017. So we're going to show you a video clip from a aria that he really, really wanted her to sing. It's called O Mio Babbino Caro, which translates to O My Dear Daddy, which is an aria by Puccini. It's sung by the female heroine Loretta after tensions between her father and the family of the boy she loves have reached a breaking point that threatens to separate the two lovers. So according to Wikipedia, this aria provides, who knows if it's real or not, provides an interlude expressing lyrical simplicity and love in contrast with the atmosphere of hypocrisy, jealousy, double dealing, and feuding. So I hope you all enjoy this video, and this video will immediately be followed by a toast that he gave at a cocktail reception that we had for her, and then this will conclude our program. I would like to give a special thank you to the wonderful team at Oz Arts here, Lauren Snelling, and Tammy Crump, Lindsay Tips, Marcy Rosenblum. A very special thank you to Michael Trebbing for all the great video work, and to Russ Snelling, our production manager, to make the place look magical and special, as you always do. Russ, brilliant job. And finally, to Miss Nancy Heathman, the brilliant graphic designer who helped with this presentation, the programs for the day, and all of your help, Nancy, working with my father, Jono, every Sunday, and helping him find the images he wanted to paint to create whatever subject he wanted to paint and create. We welcome you to hang out afterwards. We have refreshments in this room, and then we also have cigars and libations area in our back lounge and patio area. So thank you all very much for coming and being a part of this celebration of life, and you don't want to miss this video. It's pretty special. Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to recognize all of you and thank you very much for coming. I have to go to a 12th century poet to say my feelings. I love you all from my heart. I love you all from my brain. But most of all, I love you all with my soul. Because the brain will die, the heart will die, but my soul will stay forever. Thank you very much.
Lovely.